Hello, my name is Rachel Burke, and I am the membership training team leader for Indiana PTA's Common Core State Standards Initiative. And this is the presentation that we have been giving to our members so that they can learn about the Common Core State Standards.
Like it or not, life is full of measuring sticks. How smart we are, how fast we are, how well we can, you know, compete. But up until now, it's been pretty hard to tell how well kids are competing in school and how well they're going to do when they get out of school. We like to think that our education system does that. But when it comes to learning what they really need to be successful after graduation, is a girl in your neighborhood being taught as much as her friend over in the next one? Is a graduating senior in, say, St. Louis as prepared to get a job as the graduate in Shanghai? Well, it turns out the answer to both of these questions is no. Because for years, states have been setting different standards for what students should know and be able to do at each grade level. That's making it too hard to know if our kids are really doing well enough overall, and if they can really compete for a job someday. What we really need are clear goals. That's where the Common Core State Standards come in. They're like a total sea change in education. Consistent, strong, clear benchmarks for English language arts and math. Here's how it works. You can think of kindergarten through 12th grade like a giant staircase. Each step is a skill your child needs to learn before stepping up to the next one. But right now, too many kids aren't really confident with, like, 2 plus 2 before they have to move on to 2 times 2. We need more focus on the skills that help them move up the stairs, or they can slip up and fall behind. And there's another problem. What if everyone's stairs were made at different heights? Well, here we go again. They are. So, a boy in Seattle who's rocking an A in English literature could be getting a C on his Chicago friend's staircase. Oops. We need to create consistent steps in education, too. So first, each standard creates a landing on the staircase, a stop along the way as your child heads toward high school graduation. Each stop is a chance for every parent and teacher to focus on the skills their students are supposed to know at that step, no matter the zip code, language, or race. And more importantly, each standard makes sure all students are learning what they need to know to get to graduation and beyond. Because something like counting to 100 leads to understanding dollars and cents, which eventually leads to understanding how to manage a budget. Secondly, the standards are consistent from school to school, and they match up against international standards too. Now we know how we're doing compared to just about everyone. So even though local communities will still design their own curriculum, with the same rules, everybody can compete on the same kind of staircase. But standards aren't learning. That's why we need teachers, parents, and students to help make that happen by working together to help kids meet these standards. The world's getting more and more competitive every day. But now, when our kids get to the top of their staircase, they can have way more options on where their life goes from there. Clear goals, confident, well-prepared students. That's the Common Core State Standard.
Now, it's important to know that this presentation is prepared for the citizens of Indiana. What we know is that in Indiana, 70% of our everyday citizens and parents and students really don't know or understand the Common Core at all. And so we've put together this presentation as really a starting point to understanding the Common Core State Standards and what they mean. In Indiana, it's always important to ask for everyone why you're at a presentation. You know, I know that right now I have a beautiful fall day going on outside, and I have probably about a dozen places I could be this morning. And I know that everyone watching this has some places that they could be also. So what you have to think about is, why do we need to take the time to learn about this? Why is it important? And our answer is really simple. It's for our kids. We care about our kids. We love our kids. As parents and as community members, we really only have one job. And the smaller your kids are, the scarier that job is. Because your job is really to get those kids to a point to take care of them, to love them, to teach them, and to nurture them. And to get them to a point that after 12 to 15 years of public education, they get to go to commencement and start all over again. That's why we call commencement ceremonies beginnings. because that's the time for our children who we have spent all of this time loving and educating and taking care of. It's time for them to move on with their lives. It's time for them to get up and out of our homes and to go on into new places. Now, sometimes those places include going directly to get a job. Sometimes it's joining a program and becoming an apprentice somewhere. Sometimes it's enlisting in the military. And for other students, it's going on to college. But for all of these students, it needs to be to stop doing what they've been doing as children and to begin their lives as young adults. The great thing about this is that we know when that beginning is. That beginning is when one day we take them to a wonderful place where they get to walk across the stage, shake someone's hand, and get a pretty piece of paper. And that piece of paper is what has been used universally across this country. That diploma is what is used to show our children that they have moved on with their lives, that they've become adults. But our problem is that that pretty piece of paper right now, that's all it is. It doesn't symbolize something that it means something that we can trade off of. You can't say that my high school diploma means this thing. And what it means in Colorado may very well be different from what it means in Indiana, may be different from what it means in Washington, D.C. So how do we know that that pretty piece of paper isn't meaning what we want it to mean? Because we have all of these statistics that show us. But what we need for that pretty piece of paper to mean is that student is college and career ready. If you take nothing else away from this entire presentation, I want you to take those four words away from it. What we are trying to make and promote and help have our college and career-ready high school graduates. So how do we know that that's not what we're getting right now? The statistics are really quite scary. I'm going to start with the ACT College Readiness Benchmark. Now, the important thing to realize about this benchmark is that while many, many students may have taken the ACT last year, the only students that are counted in these benchmarks are the ones that actually went on to graduate from high school. So all the figures you're hearing are about actual high school graduates. And what we know is that only 24% of those actual high school graduates, 26% of those actual high school graduates met all four of the ACT benchmarks. So what are those benchmarks? They're science, mathematics, reading, and English language arts. And again, about a quarter, 26% of our students met all four of those benchmarks. And in case you're thinking, well, I don't know how high the benchmark is, I don't really know what it means, what that benchmark means is that a student in a first-year college course has a 50% chance of getting a B in that course and a 75% chance of getting a C. It's not going to college and succeeding in highest honor roll. It's going to college and succeeding to the point where they can continue. And again, only a quarter of our students are doing that. The really, truly scary thing is that 61% of our students that are graduating and have taken the ACT, 61% have met two benchmarks or fewer. 31%, that's 5% higher, have met no benchmarks at all. And as sad as it is, as bleak as those statistics are, when you start looking at minority students, the statistics become even worse. 5% of African American high school graduates last year who took the ACT were college and career ready. That's one student out of 20. So we're not just leaving all of our students behind, we're leaving those students that have been disadvantaged even more behind. The funny thing is, you know what the number one thing that the ACT recommends for fixing this problem? Implementing the college and career standard, the Common Core State Standards. They believe that the implementation of those Common Core State Standards will help lead to students being ready for real-world benchmarks in college and career success. But more than that, if you've got a student who doesn't think that they're going to go to college, that they're going to go do something else with their lives, whether it's join the military or start a job, we're still not even preparing students for that. 30% of high school graduates who take the Armed Forces Qualification Test don't pass it. So what does that mean? That means a student was interested enough in joining the military that they graduated from high school and then went on to take the Armed Forces Qualification Exam. And again, 3 out of 10 students who went on to take it didn't pass it. If you do not pass the Armed Forces Qualification Exam, you cannot enlist in the military. It's not something you can waver out of. I don't know about you, but one of the things that I know about the military is that it's the great equalizer in our society. My father was able to go to college solely because of the GI Bill. If we have 3 students out of 10 that don't qualify for military service, then that's also 3 students out of 10 who aren't qualifying to later use the GI Bill to go on and graduate from college for free. And that's a big disservice that we are doing to our youth, to our military, and to our country. The statistics for Indiana students that are in community colleges are also kind of staggering. In Indiana alone, we spend $35 million a year on remediation. So what's remediation? Remediation is when you pay to take a college class that doesn't count for college credit because it's really covering stuff you should have known in high school. So what we know in Indiana alone is that we are spending $35 million a year on remediation. What's worse than that is we know that less than 25% of those students will go on to earn any degree at all. And that's over the course of the rest of their lives. That's not that they're not going to earn a degree in the next 2 or 4 or 5 years. That's lifelong, less than 25% of students who enter community college and need remediation will get a degree. That's the rough equivalent of spending, of taking $27 million, setting it on fire, and throwing it out a window, because all of that money is being used to accomplish no goal. The other thing to remember about this statistic is that it doesn't count the $22 million that's spent in the state of Indiana remediating students that are going to four-year universities. This is only the money that is spent on two-year universities in Indiana. We also have a huge skills gap in Indiana. Indiana has had a very difficult time recovering from this recession. We're a very manufacturing-heavy state, and right now what we know is that for every unemployed Hoosier, there are 2.4 unfilled STEM jobs. A STEM job is science, technology, engineering, or mathematics. So we could fill, we could employ every unemployed Hoosier twice over without a problem if they had the skills necessary to fill those jobs. We also know that in Indiana, 54% of the jobs are classified as middle school. Now, a middle skill job is something that you need slightly more education than a high school, but less education than having graduated from college. Some examples of those jobs are licensed practical nurses, welders, electricians, and truck drivers. However, only 47% of Hoosiers have the skills and credentials in order to fill those positions, which leads us again to a 13% of those jobs remain unfilled solely because we don't have workers with the ability to fill them. 5% of all jobs in Indiana are left unfilled permanently because of a lack of qualified workers to fill them. What all these statistics really lead for us to know is the fact that the best economic recovery plan is having an adequately skilled workforce. If you look at the statistics, and these are the statistics for the entire country, of pay for high school dropouts versus high school graduates versus bachelor versus people with bachelor's degrees, the differences are staggering. A high school graduate, again, that's someone who's walked across that stage, gotten that pretty piece of paper, and has moved on to the next part of their life, are earning, on average, less than $25,000 a year. Earning more than double that amount is someone who has graduated with a bachelor's degree. They're earning roughly $53,000 a year. Also, the unemployment rate for someone with a bachelor's degree, and this is in 2011, when the unemployment rates were higher than average, was 4%. Whereas at almost triple that rate, the high school graduate unemployment rate was 11%. But even putting aside all of the academic, all of the economic measures for dealing with why we need to have a more prepared workforce, we have a whole other problem with the way that we're currently handling education in the country. And that is that right now, across the country, we have very high student mobility. Mobility, for those of you who don't know the definition of the term, can be thought of as when a student walks into one school that first day of school, and then on the last day of school walks out the door of another school. That is a student that has been mobile for that year. They've started the school in one school, they've started the year in one school, and they've ended the year in another school entirely. What we know is that in the United States, 15 to 20% of American school children move in any given year. That statistic has actually been true for quite some time. So it's not something that the recession made. The recession did make that statistic worse. We're a little closer to 20%, whereas in decades previous, we were closer to 15%. But we know that between 15 and 20% is a fairly stable number for how many school children will change schools over the course of a year. Students that live below the poverty line are twice as likely to move as those living above it. And in Indiana alone, in last year's graduating class, 16% of high school students, now that's 1 in 6, switched high schools over the course of the school year. Now, in Indiana, what is true is that high schools pull from a very large geographic area. They may have 9 elementary schools that feed to 3 middle schools that feed to 1 high school. So if the mobility rate is 16% in a high school, and that's an area covering a very large distance, what's important to realize is that for an elementary school, you're looking at a mobility rate, especially in urban areas, of about 33%, meaning that about a third of your students in elementary and middle school years are going to be changing schools over the course of the year. This moving leads to really serious problems later on. First of all, what we know is that one in six third graders has attended 3 or more schools over the course of their educational experience. Because No Child Left Behind has a very specific number of days in law, you have to be in a school for 162 days in order for your test grades to count either as a benefit to the school or as a detriment to the school. These children are not getting tracked very seriously. They're kind of slipping through the cracks. As much as No Child Left Behind meant to reach out and touch every child, thus the name of the program, these are kids that really aren't counted under it. If they switch from school to school, and if they're spending less than a school year in each school, their statistics, their test scores, how they're doing grade-wise and overall, they're not really being tracked by any school because their numbers don't count for anyone. Military students, of course, have much higher level of mobility. Typically, they will attend between 6 and 9 schools between kindergarten and 12th grade. The number of schools obviously can get much higher. It can also be slightly lower. What this leads to is really interesting situations like the ability to read an analog clock. If you leave Alaska at the end of 2nd grade and move to New York, you will never learn how to read an analog clock. Because reading an analog clock and being able to decipher what that means is a 5th grade skill in Alaska and a 2nd grade skill in New York. Now, you and I both know that reading an analog clock is a fairly simple skill to teach to an adult. And in this digital age, it's not really the end of the world if you don't know how to read that funny clock that's sitting on the wall. But this is just kind of one example of the bigger problems that we're having because of student mobility. If we're not even teaching children the relatively simple skill of how to read a clock, and we're not even guaranteeing that our kids are walking away knowing that, what other skills are slipping through the cracks because they're moving from school district and from state to state, and they don't know? And of course, what's very difficult is you don't know what you're not learning. You don't know what your child's not learning. It's always hard to kind of figure out that negative. You may realize that, hey, we read that book last year, and we're reading it again this year. That's a bit weird. But you're not going to know that you neglected to read a book. That's a harder thing to quantify as a parent. And what we know is that in the past, there were 56 sets of standards. And that kind of confuses people. So let's go through that. There's 50 states. We all know that part. Then there's the District of Columbia, okay, so that's 51. But there's also 5 U.S. territories. that the U.S. Department of Education and that parents and that is PTA, although we don't have PTAs in all of them, were responsible for. So that gives us 56 sets of standards in the United States. 50 states, District of Columbia, 5 territories. And the governors of those 50 states are all part of the National Governors Council. So the mayor of D.C. gets to be part of the National Governors Council, which I think for him must be pretty cool because everyone else is a governor. And those 56 people got together and they realized that there was a problem because there were 56 sets of standards and students that are living in their state, who may have lived in someone else's state, are losing things, they're learning things twice, they don't really, they're getting lost between the gaps. So they got together with the Council of Chief State School Officers. That is whoever in your state is legally in charge of your education system. Here, that's our state superintendent of public instruction, Glenda Ritz. In some states, it's an elected position. It is here in Indiana. In other states, it's an appointed position. I know it is in Florida. So those 112 people got together, and they decided that they needed to come up with a solution for solving this mobility problem and the fact that we are graduating students from high school who are not college and career ready. So they went to a bunch of different groups and they asked them questions. They went to four-year state colleges, they went to community colleges, they went to the Department of Defense, Chambers of Commerce, industry, skilled labor, certifications programs, that's things like stagecraft or HVAC, you know, heating and air conditioning repair, and beautician, formal apprenticeship programs, that's things like stagecraft and HVAC repair, certification programs, my apologies, things like cosmetology licenses and things like that. And they asked all of these diverse groups, and again, these are, you know, people going off to college for 4 years versus people getting a certificate that's going to allow them to work tomorrow versus people going into the military versus people that are going directly into the manufacturing labor pool. And they asked all of these varied groups one question. And that question is, what do you expect a high school graduate to know and be able to do on the day that they graduate from high school? That's it. So all of those different groups gave different lists. And what the National Governors Association and the Chief of State School Officers did is they took that list, all of those lists from all of those different groups, and they made that the end of 12th grade. So that's what you need to know at the end of 12th grade. And so they then went to education experts and curriculum experts, and they said, okay, we know what we need our students to know at the end of 12th grade. So what we need you to figure out is if they know this at the end of 12th grade, what do they need to know at the end of 11th grade? And if they know this at the end of 11th grade, then how can we work back to find out what they would need to know at the end of 7th grade or at the end of 3rd grade or even all the way down to the end of kindergarten? And so they were able to build a stair step of standards. That would get us to, again, our ultimate goal is to know what we need to know at the end of 12th grade, what that pretty piece of paper means, that college and career readiness standard. However, after they went to education experts, they also realized that they needed to go to people who actually teach children. And so they went to people working in the classroom. And this is every state that took part of the initiative, so it's everyone but Texas and Alaska, and 3 of the 5 territories. So they went to all of those people and they said, okay, here's what higher ed has told us. Here's what the people with the PhDs and the researchers have told us. As teachers, as people who work with these students every day, how do we need to change it to work for the real world? And they did that. They took those standards and they tweaked them. They allowed those people to go in and tweak them and mess with them and move something that maybe someone in higher ed thought was the 3rd grade but was really more appropriately socially and intellectually for a 4th grader, and they fit those all into pieces. The important thing to know is that these standards were not delivered from the federal government. They did not come down from on high. They were put together by state officials, by educators that are working in classrooms in all 48 states that were involved in the process. This was not a federal government initiative. This was a state and local initiative. Okay, so we figured out how the standards were formed. the next question becomes, how are they different? Because we had standards before, and we had teachers who were really good at teaching the standards before, and yet we're still kind of in this mess. So what's the difference going to be? Why did these standards need to change? It's not to the previous set of standards that were used across the country, but they were different. Generally, they taught how to do things. How do I add fractions? They taught students to memorize things. When did the Battle of Gettysburg take place? They taught students where things took place. You know, where is Antietam? Where is Sharpsburg? Find it on a map. And they taught them to memorize when. You know, when did these battles take place? Very, very factual and pointed pieces of data that you could look at. What you might notice about the last three things is they're all things that you can find in a really good encyclopedia, or even an okay encyclopedia. And that really is the big difference. What we're going to now is the Common Core standards. Okay, so how do things change? They're teaching critical thinking skills. They're teaching, okay, not just how to add fractions, but why are you doing the steps that you're doing in order to add fractions? If you're given this problem, is adding fractions the right way to get to the solution, or is multiplying fractions? They're teaching why it works, getting deep down and figuring out, okay, we've been given this set of skills. Look at that set of skills. Why is that getting us to where we need to get to? They're being taught how to problem solve. Again, this is, do you want to add here? Do we want to multiply? Do we want to do a combination of the two of them? They're also being taught to analyze and synthesize data. Instead of being worried about when the battle took place and where it took place, why did it take place on that day? Why did it take place the day before or the day after? And how was the outcome of that battle determined? And really, more importantly, how did the outcome of that battle affect the rest of the war? The real difference is that we're teaching children thinking skills. What we need as a democracy, as educators, as parents, are people who have the ability to think, who have the ability to take information and to come up with their own answers for solutions. Now, we may not agree with those answers, especially in teenagers, but we still need to know that our kids have the ability to take pieces of information and to put together arguments and to use those arguments to synthesize data. And that's really the big difference. Instead of teaching children what to think, and instead of teaching children specific items, we're teaching them how to learn about thinking and how to put things together and how to make arguments for themselves and also how to come up with arguments for themselves. Instead of teaching them why something is, we're going to give them the data and let them come up with the why for themselves. Because that's a skill that as an adult and as just a person, you need to be able to do. That skill is going to help us have students who can determine truth from fiction and also be able to look at something and understand immediately that it's propaganda. And again, this is an important skill not just for 12th graders, but for adults going through an election cycle. That ad on the news, who's paying for it? Why does it matter? What are they trying to convince you of? And should you listen? Those are the sort of critical thinking skills that our kids have to have in order to go out into this world where they're going to be where they're going to be hit with all of that data coming in from everywhere. They need to be able to look at that data and discern, is someone trying to change my opinion about something? Or is this an actual fact coming from an unbiased source? I think it's important to think about this in a way that makes sense for people. And so the best way that I have for that is to look at math. And I know that not everyone's a math person, so it's okay. We're going to get on to some language arts cases later on, but we're going to start with math. In math, a lot of the criticism has been about the teaching of addition. So we're going to look at it. If you've got it, okay, we know 6 plus 8 equals 14. However, it also equals 10 plus 4. So as adults, it seems really simplistic. I mean, why are we bothering to teach kids that 6 plus 8 equals 10 plus 4 equals 14? That just seems silly. The important thing about this is if you have kindergartners and first graders that are getting down into numbers and manipulating them, that are comfortable enough to go, hey, 6 plus 8, you know, that's the same thing as 10 plus 4. I can regroup it. It's also the same thing as 7 plus 7. And they're getting down and they're playing and they're becoming comfortable with mathematics. It leads to people that later on realize that 19 by 19 is the same thing as 20 by 20 minus 20 minus 19. The 19 by 19, even though I cannot multiply in my head particularly well, I know for a fact that's 361 because I'm comfortable with mathematics. And that's a skill that's useful as an adult. You know, you may not understand why it's necessary to teach kids that 6 plus 8 equals 10 plus 4, but you should understand that it's necessary to teach kids that 19 plus 9 times 19 equals 20 times 20 minus 20 minus 19. But what's even more important than teaching children how to do that is getting them comfortable with numbers. In order to make little baby engineers and little baby scientists and little baby mathematicians, we need people that aren't afraid of numbers. We need people that are comfortable and that have been down in the dirt with the numbers, playing with them and manipulating them and getting comfortable with them at a very young age, seeing them as not something that's scary, but rather something that can be played with. And that knowledge will help them greatly later in life and also help them in getting a career. So we get to adding fractions. For years and years and years, if you think back to how you learned to add fractions, you'll know that it had something to do with finding the least common multiple and the greatest common factor, and then you would put them together somehow and magically get a solution, right? Maybe. But it was kind of confusing. People were taught a process for getting a solution without actually being taught what the solution was. A study was done by the ACT on ninth graders who had successfully proven that they could add fractions. So these are kids that we know can reliably add fractions on a test. And 80% of them did not know why what they were doing works. That should scare you. You shouldn't be able to do something without knowing why what you're doing works. You should be able to express, okay, I'm multiplying by 1. If I multiply by 1, that doesn't change the answer. And so I'm still going to get there. You should be able to, as an adult and as someone solving the problem, express why the steps that you're taking work. Of course, the other big secret about mathematics is that all of these steps that they will get you to the solution, they're not the only way to get there. In math, there's often many, many ways to get to the same answer. Cross-multiplying, just as valid a way of getting to the solution than using the least common multiple and the greatest common factor. The other dirty secret in mathematics is that in the end, 1/2 really does equal 2/4, really does equal 4/8. You don't need to worry so much about getting the answer in the perfect form as much as knowing how to get the correct answer and to reliably be able to get there and know why what you're doing works. And again, that gets us to the big thing, why? Why is what you're doing works? Why are you choosing these steps to solve the problem? The largest survey ever conducted of community college members took place in 2011. So every student in every community college across the United States was asked to look at the following problem: A over 5 and A over 8. Now, assuming that A is any whole positive number, they were asked, which one is larger? Okay, so we have a problem with only 2 possible solutions. That means if you put 100 people in the room, you don't even tell them what they are, and you have them guess, 50% of them are going to get the problem right, and 50% of them are going to get the problem wrong. The truly terrifying thing with this study is that only 53% of the people who took the test got it right. 53% is significantly insignificant, is insignificant statistically. That means that realistically, we have millions upon millions of people in community college that have gotten to the point that they can add fractions, but they don't understand the basic principle of what a fraction is. They don't understand that if they look at 1/5 versus 1/8, they can also think of it as looking at, in this particular problem, 5/5 versus 5/8, and which one is always going to be larger and which one is always going to be smaller, and how fractions work. They do not understand. In essence, you could have flipped a coin and people would have gotten the correct answer the same amount of the time. We can't continue to do that to our students. We have got to graduate students that know what they're doing and why they're doing it. I think it's important that if you're going to look at standards, talk about standards, that you actually look at them. I use fifth grade standards because last year I had a fifth grader, and so they were something I dealt with a lot. You can look at both sets of standards, your current state standards as well as Common Core standards, online and refer to them that way. The first thing I want to talk about, though, is this fifth grade standard really quickly. I'm only putting up the Common Core standards because there's a lot of criticism about Common Core across the country, and it's that we're not actually teaching children math facts. You're teaching them all those other things, and you don't care if they get the math facts wrong. This standard disproves that. This is the fifth grade standard that it comes to dealing with operations, and what it says is that a student has to be able to fluently multiply multi-digit whole numbers. So what does that mean? It means a kid has to know their math facts. Fluently multiplying is knowing instantaneously the answer to a math problem that is fairly simple. You know, if I were to say 3 times 3 is, you would say 9. Or what is 5 times 8? Or what is 7 times 9? Those are all things that you know inherently because they were drilled into you for years. That's fluency. And in the Common Core, there is an actual standard that requires fluency. And so the entire argument that kids aren't being required to learn the math facts, not true. There are standards that prove that otherwise. So this is, again, comparing a previous Indiana standard to a Common Core standard. And it has to do with fractions. And I don't want to read the entire thing because you're all adults and you can read this yourself. But one of the big differences is that if you look at the Common Core standard, it says explain why multiplying a given number by a fraction greater than 1 results in something, and then explain the principles of fraction equivalence to the effect of multiplying by 1. The Indiana standard says that you do have to be able to use models, but the important thing is that you can multiply and divide fractions to solve problems. They don't really care so much that you know why as much as that you're able to do it. It's important to know how to be able to do these things. I mean, we've seen all the statistics, I've already shown them to you, about why knowing this is important. And this is really where it begins. Okay. So let's think about this. If I multiply 500 by 1/2, I'm getting less. But that doesn't seem to make sense, because if you multiply, usually you get more. So why would multiplying 500 by 1/2 lead to less? Well, if we think of multiplication as repeated addition of like terms, then what we're saying is if you take 500 of half of something, what do you get? Well, half of something is less than all of something. So that makes sense as to why the number is going to go down. So why 500 times 1/2 is less than 500, but why 500 times 2, because if we take 500 twos, that's over 1, then your number is going to go up. And the same thing comes to dividing by fractions. You know, dividing by fractions is one of those skills that we teach and teach and teach you. Flip the second number and you multiply, hey, everything magically works. But it's really hard to actually think about. What are you really doing if you're dividing by 1/3? So if you divide 6 by 1/3, okay, we know you flip 1/3 or you get 3, so 6 times 3 is 18. So we can all do that in our head. But what does it mean? Using the Common Core standard, students will have to explicitly state that what that means is if I have 1/3 of something, how many of those 1/3 will fit into the number 6. Okay, so that makes sense. If there are 3/3 in 1, so that's 3. So then it would be 3 times 6 is 18. But they have to explicitly state what dividing by a fraction really is doing, not just what the answer is. And that's a huge change in thinking. That's making sure that children understand what they're doing and can tell someone else why what they're doing works. So English language arts, we're going to flip over to the other side for people for whom math isn't, you know, they're in their wheelhouse. We're going to go over to the other one. There's this entire thing about Common Core and how 70% of what you read in grade 12 has to be nonfiction, which is true. That is the expected result. And so this is entire argument that we're never going to learn Hamlet, we're not going to read A Christmas Carol, chaos will reign, literature classes across the country will shut down. Okay, let's think about this. If your high school only has six periods, most high schools here have seven, but even if you only have six, that means 16% of your student's day is held in one class period, which means a student can take two literature classes every day and be fulfilling the 70-30% split. So they can read nothing but nonfiction in two language arts classes every day and still meet the requirement. I don't know about you, but personally, I prefer that my children read fiction in English class rather than in, say, science or social studies and math. When they're studying science and social studies and math, I expect that they're reading fact. I find that to be very important. And so what I'm trying to say here is that reading great pieces of literature, reading pieces of literature that are important to your school and community, that's not going to go away. Two periods out of six can still be dealt, can still do nothing but read nonfiction, I mean, read fiction to the students and the teacher's heart's content. There's no reason for a literature teacher to start teaching how to read an electronic manual. They get to still read all of those classics that they have known and loved and things that are important to their community. But on a broader range, what I want you to know is that adults who read, and this is adults that are avid readers, adults who read books for pleasure, among that specific group of adults, 80% of what they read is expository or nonfiction text. I do a lot of reading. I read a lot of books, but I read the news a whole lot more. Also, I do a lot of reading and I read a lot of books and I value literature, but in the end, knowing how to read the manual for my drill so I can fix my desk tomorrow when I bought a brand new drill today, that's still an important skill to have. You don't have to throw out literature in order to learn important skills using nonfiction reading. And as an adult, that you're going to mirror what is going on in the classroom in your own home. The other big change dealing with the Common Core standards in the English language arts is a lot more discussion of why. In history, why is the big thing. What we used to teach kids in high school, I'm going to use the Louisiana Purchase as an example, with a lot of names and dates. So Thomas Jefferson, he sent a couple of people over in a boat to France. Boom, size of the country doubled. Yay, everyone's happy. In high school, you used to just learn names, dates, what happened. That was really it. So if you ever go on to take any college history class, all of a sudden, everything changes because you learn really quickly that in college history classes, they look at you and they go, hey, you can find all of that stuff in a book. And you can. The important parts of history, the important thing that historians study are the why. Why did the Louisiana Purchase happen in the way that it did? Now, I use Louisiana Purchase because there's two great big schools of thought in history. One is Thomas Jefferson is the most brilliant president that has ever lived. He sends two people over to France, and they come back, and they have doubled the size of the country. Manifest destiny is happily on its way, and the United States goes on to become huge and span the continent eventually. Go us. The other school of thought is that Thomas Jefferson was the luckiest president that we have ever had. He sends two people on a boat over to France, and in the meanwhile, Napoleon's brother-in-law dies, having been killed by L'Ouverture in a revolt on Hispaniola. Napoleon decides he is absolutely done with the New World and hands the Louisiana Territory over to Thomas Jefferson and the United States for a song. So which one's right? Are they both right? Are they both wrong? Why do you believe one or the other? So how would you do that? We can look at newspaper articles written in the United States at that time. We can look at newspaper articles written in France. They're talking about the same thing. How are they talking about it differently? What are they saying? We can investigate other sources. We can look at letters written to Napoleon from his wife that are talking about the death of her brother. Now, a letter from a wife to a husband is a very specific type of propaganda. It is being written to convey a very specific personal goal. It's not being written as a nonfiction piece for which he needs to determine the fate of his country by. But still, if Napoleon is getting a letter from his wife, how much is that letter going to help determine what his final decision is going to be. Also, we're talking about France in the early 1800s. There were little propaganda pamphlets everywhere about everything. And there were a lot of pamphlets about the Louisiana Purchase, and they went both ways. We should get rid of the territory. There's nothing but a weight around our neck. We should keep it and go off into glorious things in the New World once this little issue that we're having is solved. So look at both sets of pamphlets. What point are they trying to make? How much relative importance do we give a pamphlet over a letter to a wife, over a newspaper article, over death lists coming in from Hispaniola? Which of these things are ultimately, in the end, what's influencing Napoleon's decision? And the great thing about a question like that is there's not a right answer. You are not Napoleon. Therefore, you cannot possibly know why, in the end, he made the decision he made. But if you put yourself in his shoes and you look at all of these pieces of data, why would you make the decision? So what is your argument for why we got to Louisiana Territory? If we ask students that, we can get 30 different well-thought-out articles, well-thought-out arguments to the same question. And that's the beauty about actually teaching children how to think, is that they can make their own reasoned argument using sources and telling us, I used this source because I believed blah. I threw out this source for this reason, because the things you throw out and why you throw them out are just as important as the things you keep and why you choose to keep them. And giving our students the ability to make those choices and to think deliberately and specifically about the choices they're making and why they're making them, that is power. And that power leads to things not just the Louisiana Purchase, but the decisions that they make in their everyday life. Why do they choose one contractor over another? How do they vote on a referendum? Things like that. We're giving them the skills to be able to make well-thought-out decisions later in life without someone tapping them on the shoulder and telling them what that decision needs to be. So again, we're going to do a little bit of standard comparison. This is a good one that I like a lot. The Indiana Standard requires that you distinguish between facts and fiction. And the example that they give, and I love this standard for no other reason than the example to determine facts and opinions in an editorial page. I don't know about you, the last time I checked, editorial pages were by definition opinions. This is not a difficult skill to treat, to teach. Is it on the editorial page? Okay, it's an opinion. Is it on the front page being given to you as news? Okay, it's supposed to be fact. This is really simple. The Common Core State Standard requires analyzing multiple accounts of the same center topic, noting similarities and differences in the point of view they represent. And again, this is where the real power in thinking comes from. If you read newspaper articles about the same event written by people with different viewpoints, how are they going to change? The big one to think about this is, did we fight the Civil War, or did we fight the War of Northern Aggression? Look at newspapers written across the country then. Look at the outbreak of war and how they write about it. They're writing about the exact same event, and yet both sides are blaming the other simultaneously and saying, the other guy started it, it was his fault, not ours. How can they do that if they're writing facts? Okay, so we're going to have students look at those, and we're going to have them look at the articles covering the same thing taking place on the same day. And we're going to say, how did you get those two differences? Is it the geography of where it's coming from? Is it the sources that they're using to report? What is leading it? And again, that investigating text is the sort of thinking we want our kids to be able to do. I also really, really love this one. The Indiana State Standard has to do with teaching kids synonyms, antonyms, homographs, similes, and metaphors. Again, these are all pretty simple. They have the same meaning. They have different meanings. They use the word like or as. They do not use the word like or as. I mean, this is pretty simple to come through, right? The Common Core State Standard, it says, demonstrate understanding of figurative language, word relationships, and nuances in word meanings. This shows two things. First of all, it shows that the Common Core standards can be and do tend to be much shorter and more succinct. You can combine various standards into one in a Common Core. But also, for English specifically, the word nuance is important. The English language is built around nuance. And nuance is something that is far more difficult to teach and to think about than something like a synonym or an antonym. Okay, the word clean and the word spotless are both synonyms. Which floor would you prefer to eat off of? When discussing nuance in metaphor and tone, the word cerulean and the word blue are also both synonyms. But we would not describe a football player's uniform as cerulean and describe a dress that a ballerina is in as blue. The words have different implied tone and meaning, and that's the really important thing about the English language, is this tone and meaning and relationship between words, and the distinction that we have between one word and another that can mean the exact same thing is used in a completely different context. What this change is going to lead to is in an English language arts class going, okay, so on page 8, the author used the word eyes in a very specific descriptive way, and then he did it again on page 164. I want you to tell me why the author repeated that word, and what does it mean? You know, is the author trying to make you think about what happened on page 8? Is the author trying to describe the similarity between the two people that he's describing or the two objects that he's describing? Is he trying to show how they're different, but they only have this one thing to say? What is the author trying to do? Why did the author choose that specific word on that specific page? And what is that choice trying to convey to you? Again, doing this is much deeper than just looking at and being able to critically analyze literature, though that is an incredibly important skill. It is also something that will go on to be reflective of later in life. What is what you are reading trying to convince you to do or trying to remind you of? And that's a skill that we need to have adults know. And we're teaching it under the Common Core standards in as young as fifth grade. In fifth grade, they have to start thinking about nuances of words. And to me, that is just a wonderful thing because, again, nuance is what makes our language what it is. It's what makes our conveying and expressions of ideas what they are. In the end, the best way, the best word to describe the Common Core State Standard is rigor. What the standards will do is that they will introduce rigor and they will increase rigor where it already was. We are going to make kids think more and harder. We're going to not let them get away with just giving us an answer. They're going to have to explain why that answer is. And it's going to be more than just showing your work. It's explaining why you chose to go down the road you chose to go down. You know, not just, well, I decided to add fractions. Why did you decide to add fractions? Why was that the appropriate thing to do? Show me the words that made you think you needed to add fractions. And that's the important difference, is that we're not just teaching skills and drills. We're not just teaching facts and figures. We're teaching thought. Again, we're not telling kids what to think, but we're teaching them how to do it. How to think, how to problem solve, how to critically analyze. And all of that goes back to rigor. We are adding rigor to what our kids are currently doing. And that's going to go straight back to college and career readiness. We are getting our kids ready to go out into the real world and succeed. To succeed in everyday life, to succeed in college, to succeed in the career of their choice. We want our kids to be successful. We want that pretty piece of paper to mean something. And the college and career standards are giving us that meaning. They're giving us that answer. They're giving us the what does this mean and can I take it someplace else and have it mean the same thing? Yes. It means that you are ready to start a new part of your life. It means that you are ready for college and that you can be successful there. It means that you are ready to go on into the real world. And that to me is just, it's truly, truly the importance of all of these things. I want to know that my kids are ready to succeed. But more than that, as just a human being and a member of society and a taxpayer and a PTA member, I want to know that everyone else's kids are also. I want to know that what we're teaching our children is going to make them young adults and adults that will be good citizens, that will know how to make an argument and know how to come to a decision for themselves. Even if I don't agree with that decision, I want to know that they put thought into it and they came up with an answer in a specific way. That is the value of the Common Core standards. On top of moving away from a place where we are throwing millions upon millions of dollars into remediation that is leading to virtually nothing, we are also leading to a population that will be better educated and better suited to pursue life in the real world. And that's the power of what we're going towards. We're going towards a new way of thinking about education, a new way of thinking about thinking. You're expecting students to take a big jump from where they are now to where they need to be. But I want you as parents and as educators and as people involved in education to think about this. Would you rather have kids have a hard year when they're in sixth grade and in fourth grade or in seventh grade? Or would you rather have them have that hard year when they're a freshman in college paying $20,000 to be there a year and it's for all the marbles? I know that I, as a parent, would much rather have that hard time happen now so that I know that when my kid gets to college, they're going to be prepared for it. And that's what makes the Common Core State Standards so important. Thank you.